Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so in last class we studied logistic regression and also looked at how, you know, we can convert these generative models into discriminative models and what are the connections for classification. So in this class we will study similar type of connections for clustering. Okay, so in particular, let's say, so you have already seen k-means algorithm, right? Today we'll see how this k-means algorithm, which seems to be a very sort of deterministic algorithm and a sort of optimization based algorithm, and we'll see how it is connected to these generative models and how it comes about using, you know, probability distributions over data and generative distributions over the data. Okay. So can you remind me the k-means algorithm? So what is the task in k-means algorithm first of all? Okay, good. So let's say I have, I'm given a data set and I have n points x1, x2 till xn. Each xi, let's say, is in R to power d. So the goal is to cluster these points into, let's say, k clusters. So c1, c2, so on till some c capital K. I want to cluster into these k clusters. And so how does k-means go about it? So how is each cluster represented in k-means? By average of the data point. So I want to represent each of my cluster by their means, mu1, mu2 till mu k. And for each data point, I have a sort of indicator variable. So for xi, I have, let's say, my cluster indicator variable, which tells me, so if xi, let's say class of xi is equal to j, it is one only when, you know, when I know that my class of xi should be equal to j, otherwise it is zero. Okay. That is, it's just an indicator variable of in which cluster my data point belongs to. Okay. And the goal in k-means is now to estimate the means as well as this cluster indicator, that is, this point belongs to this class, right? So the objective function that you want to minimize is that I want to find mu1, mu2 till mu k, such that for all points that belong, so I want to do the summation over all my classes. So let's say k is equal to 1 to capital K. And I want to sum over all my data points that belongs to class K. Let me use j here. And then what I want is that within each class, my L2 norm distance to the mean is not very large. That is, if I have, let's say, a set of points here and a set of points here, I want to find means mu1 and mu2 so that the distance of points that belong to cluster 1 to the mean is small. And similarly, distance of point that belong to cluster 2 to the mean is small. So naturally, I will try to assign all my points here to this mean. Suppose if I have a point here, if I assign to this mean, the distance will be very large. So that is not desirable. So that's why it will give me a cluster. Right. So given a set of points, I want to find a set of means and the cluster indicator variable so that this overall sum is minimized, where this quantity is within cluster distance or and I want to say that each of the cluster is sort of homogeneous. The distance within each of the cluster or the error root, the squared error within each of the cluster is small. I should not call it distance. Okay. So how does k-means go about solving this problem? Yeah, I mean, we'll study EM later, but it's so it's a alternative type of procedure where first let's say fix mu old 1 to mu old k, and then I assign my points to clusters. And that is very easy because if I fix my means, then this objective function will just depend on each. So if I want to minimize error for one data point by assignment, it will just depend on that data point. It is independent of all other data points. And if I want to minimize that error, I should assign to the point cluster that is nearest to it. Right. And once I do that, then I have to recompute mu1, mu2 till mu k, new. And then just reiterate. Iterate over this procedure. Yeah. This is a simple sort of optimization based method. And it's known that this problem in general is NP hard. Yeah. But if there are some good separation conditions, for example, if the data points are like within one cluster, data points are reasonably far away from the other cluster, and the initialization is proper, then you will get to an approximate solution. As in, so whatever, so if this is my j mu1, mu2 till mu k, then whatever solution that I find, that will be less than equal to some 20 times or so j of mu1 star, mu2 star. That is, with respect to optimal cluster centers, I'll be within some constant factor, assuming some conditions and good initialization, because initialization is very critical here. If I initialize, let's say, both my cluster centers somewhere around here, then the what can happen is that I will get one cluster like this and one another cluster like this, which will be very bad. Okay. So now let's see how it, like, is there any generative process behind this type of algorithm? Is this problem has its origins in some generative models? And since we have, like, in the objective function, we have this 2 norm square. So that sort of should give you an idea that, okay, maybe let's consider our favorite Gaussian distributions, and they typically give rise to these type of distances. So let's look at Gaussians. Okay, so let's say I have two Gaussian distributions with mean mu1 and covariance sigma1, sigma2. And what I do is I sample data points from this distribution, sample data points from this distribution. So I'll sample some points like this, sample points like this. Okay. So my generative process is the following. I'll select one of the clusters with some probability. And then once I select a cluster, I'll sample a data point from that cluster. And by sampling data point from a cluster means that I'm sampling point from that Gaussian distribution, which is centered at, let's say, mean mu 1 and covariance covariance sigma 1. That is, first I have some indicator variable or some latent variable z, which tells me my cluster center. And so the z can be from, you know, actually let me not call this z, let me call it h. And this h can take values from, let's say, 1, 2 till k. Okay. And then given h, my probability of sampling x is given by mu h comma sigma h. That is given my cluster's indicator or the cluster that I want to select. I will then sample my points from distributions of this type. Okay, this is clear. Cool. So how can I write my in general probability distributions x? So you can write this as summation over all z, pz, p of x given z, right? And that is given by summation, where, or actually I was calling it h, so h, okay, where h can go from 1 to k. And then this pH is my, let's say, mixing weight or probability of my hth cluster. So let me call it just pi h. And this is my Gaussian, mean mu h. Okay. So I'm just writing it as this. So this is sort of a prior on my cluster that, okay, what is the likelihood of one of my clusters, of my hth cluster. And then once I figure out that, I will sample from that cluster or from that Gaussian distribution. Okay. So this p of x can be thought of as parameterized by these guys, right? So actually, let me call this theta. So you have a set of parameters here. And what are the parameters? My parameters are mu 1, mu 2 till mu k, sigma 1, sigma 2 till sigma k, and then pi 1, that is my cluster priors, pi 2 till pi h. Right? So I have sort of three sets of parameters: my means, my covariances, and my mixing parameters, or my weights of each cluster, prior on each cluster. Okay. So now what would be the goal in my inference algorithm? My goal would be that given a data set x1, x2 till xn generated from this probability distribution, I want to estimate my parameters. Okay. That's good. So let's just write. So we know that whenever we want to do this type of parameter estimation in these Bayesian models, we just try to look for either maximum likelihood estimate or maximum a posteriori estimate. So let's just go with maximum likelihood estimate, which is simpler. So my likelihood function of, or my probability of this data set X given theta, I'm assuming that each of my data points is sampled IID. So that will be I is equal to 1 to n p of xi given theta, and that will be, so, and let me look at the likelihood, log likelihood function, that is L of x comma theta as log of p is given theta, and that is given by summation I is equal to 1 to n log of summation h is equal to 1 to k pi h times n mu h sigma h. Right? This is my log likelihood function. Pxi theta is given by this. Actually, I should write xi x given mu h comma sigma to make it clear. And xi given mu h comma sigma h. Okay. Is it clear? And now what I want to do is I want to find out my parameters theta, that is mu, sigma and pi, so that this quantity is maximized. Okay. So any idea how to optimize for this? So can you see, like, so there are two fundamental difficulties with directly optimizing this. So first issue is that the problem itself is sort of ill-defined. Because suppose what happens is, I take one of my point, let's say some xj, to be my mu j, okay? Sorry, mu h. And I take sigma h to be close to zero, okay? So what will happen? All my other points will have reasonable likelihood. That is, what I want to do is, if I have a set of points, I'm saying that all these points are generated from some, let's say mu 1, sigma 1, and this point is generated from my mu 2 and its sigma 2 is around 0 because there is just one single point. So naturally my variance here is 0 for this distribution, right? So this is one possible set of parameters that I can try to fit to my data, right? There is no harm in that. And let's look at the likelihood of this. So these guys will have a finite likelihood because, well, sure, the likelihood won't be very good. It won't be very high, but at least it will be finite. I mean, there's certainly a probability, so let's say my mu h is here. There's certainly a chance that all these points were generated from a Gaussian that was centered at mean mu h and had some sigma, or sorry, mu 2, and had some covariance sigma 2. I mean, there is certain likelihood for sure. And when you look at this guy's likelihood now, that goes to infinity because, so remember, so because my likelihood is this, so I know that normal distribution of mu 2 given mu 2 comma 0 is essentially 1 by root 2 pi, let me call it sigma 2 here, 1 by root 2 pi sigma 2, right? And if sigma 2 is 0, this will tend to infinity. The e to power, this term just vanishes because my mean is same as the point, right? Mu 2 minus mu 2 square by sigma 2. So this will be 0. So this whole quantity will be just 1. And this will be my likelihood in this term. And as I said sigma 2 to be very small, this will just shoot up. So this estimation problem itself is ill-defined in some sense. Right? And another issue is that suppose I somehow avoid these issues, still how do I maximize for this likelihood? So if you remember our MLE estimates for Gaussians, we know that if there was no pi here, sorry, sigma here, if we had to just maximize for, you know, that is points that are coming from one cluster, we would have been able to do that easily. We just would take average of all the points, that will give me the mean of my Gaussian, and then taking covariance will give me covariance of the, that is taking summation xi xi transpose minus mean mu mu transpose will give me the covariance as well. But as soon as you have this summation term here, it's not clear how to optimize it. There is no easy way to see how to optimize it. Okay. So for this type of problems, EM algorithms are very useful. Okay, so essentially what they try to do is they try to take the summation out of the picture and basically put somewhere here. Like that's on a very, like, you know, very roughly, that's what EM type of algorithms tries to do. That is, they just want to optimize over one single Gaussian and then reinitialize things. Okay. So these algorithms were proposed, I think, in 70s, some really well-known statisticians, I think Dempster and all. So the algorithm is the following. So it's called expectation maximization. Or EM. Okay. So in this algorithm, so overall, like, the main idea of the algorithm is that in the expectation step, that is E step, what you do is you assume your parameters to be fixed. That is, you assume that you have some mu's and sigmas and pi's, and from that compute the probability that your point xi given theta old, let's say, belongs to cluster G. So this is my probability distribution over all the clusters. So Z, or let me actually call it H only. No, actually I should define as variable Z. And so what does this say? This probability distribution will say that what is the probability of xi belonging to cluster G. So this is a discrete probability distribution, z is equal to h to cluster h. Okay, so I want to estimate the entire distribution. So this z is a random variable that can take values 1 2 till k, and I want to estimate this. Okay, so in each step, that's what you do. You figure out these probabilities. And in the case of Gaussians, it's fairly easy, right? So I know my means. Okay. And then what I want to, so all I have to do is compute, and so I know my means and the priors as well. So this will be equal to, so probability that Z is equal to H is just pi H. My chances that I lie in hth cluster divided by my overall probabilities, and then just normalize it. So let's say j is equal to 1 to k, just sum it over all the j's. Okay. So right now I am not giving you any sort of formal way of deriving this EM algorithm. I just want to convey the intuition that this is what it is doing, and then we'll see how formally EM algorithm comes about and how it is able to maximize your likelihood. Why one should use it? What are the sort of basic principles behind it? But first, let's just understand how we can do this business. So what I do is I fix my theta, my set of parameters, and then I just compute the probability that xi belongs to cluster H. And that is just given by this, right? This is my probability of belonging to H, and then I have to just normalize it. This is sort of conditional probability, right? So this step is clear. And then once I have determined these probabilities, then I just need to compute my cluster means covariances. Right. So I know that what is the chances that each of my point belong to a given cluster, and then for Gaussians, when I want to compute the cluster these parameters mu h and sigma h, all I have to do is I have to average out my points. But now, since the chances that my point belongs to my this given cluster is again a probability distribution. It can be between 0 to 1, so I just weight by that, right? That seems intuitive. So essentially, so mu h now, the way I will sum is that summation over all my points, 1 to n, 1 by n, probability that okay, times the point. Okay, that is, I just average all my points, but weighted by the probability that the point belongs to this given cluster H. And similarly, my covariance also, I will again just compute usual covariance, but weighted by this probability distribution. Times xi minus mu h, xi minus mu h transpose. And finally, my mixing parameter is also, so this is just my probability of picking a cluster, right? That what is the weight on that particular cluster. So here also, it's, so if my, all these probabilities were 0, 1, then it will be just how many points I have in that particular cluster, right? And then divided by total number of points. So again, this is just z is equal to h given xi theta old. Actually, the indicators are also points dependent. Okay. So this is what is called M step, and I mean maximization step or expectation maximization. So again, so very basic idea: you fix your set of parameters, you find out the probability that a given point belongs to a cluster, and then once I find out that, I just reweight that. Basically, I just recompute my means and then covariance and then the mixing parameter by just taking a weighted average of my points, weighted according to probability that it belongs to that particular cluster. Okay. So I've talked at a very intuitive level that, okay, this is what one should be doing, but there's a very sort of nice basic framework behind this, fundamental framework behind this approach. So that, let's discuss that. Okay. So at least this algorithm is clear at intuitive level, right? So, so actually, even before going there, let me first establish connection to k-means, and then we will see the more general framework. Okay. So remember, we said that probability of zi is equal to h given xi and then my mu h sigma h was pi h n xi given, actually I should call it just theta old, divided by summation over all my clusters. Right. Now let's consider a special case where, you know, the way I initialize my my theta old is that each of the sigma h is essentially just a diagonal matrix sigma, okay, that is sort of a spherical Gaussian, and my variance is fixed to be sigma, okay, and furthermore my variance is extremely small, sigma tends to zero, okay, So now let's look at this quantity, what it will give us as sigma tends to 0. So the top guy is, so you have pi h e to power minus xi minus mu h square by sigma square divided by summation g psi minus mu g square to sigma square. Now note that sigma is tending to 0, right? So if let's say xi was close to mu h, like xi was closest to mu h, that is xi minus mu h was less than xi minus mu j for all other j, then what will happen? This quantity will dominate the most, right? So whichever quantity I'm, whichever mean I'm closest to, that particular mean will dominate and all other terms will be close to zero. So this probability will be around one for points that are closest, or sorry, means that are closest, and zero otherwise, right? So probability of zi is equal to h xi theta old will tend to one if xi minus mu h is less than equal to xi minus, or is less than xi minus mu j for all j not equal to h, and otherwise it will be zero, right? So this is very similar to our k-means case, right? That is, we are assigning point xi to a cluster mu h depending on its distance. Just find the closest cluster center and assign to that cluster, right? And then when we are computing our, let's say, mean, so what is that? This is probability of zi is equal to h given xi theta old. H goes from 1 to, sorry, I goes from 1 to n, and then xi, right? So we know that this quantity will be 1 only for those guys which are closest to our old mu h and zero otherwise. So what we'll do is we'll just figure out all the points that were closest to our old cluster centers and then update our new cluster centers according to that. So this is mean updation procedure in k-means. Okay. And then similarly, our pi h will also be summation I is equal to 1 to n, 1 by n, p z I is equal to h given x I comma theta old. That is, it will just select all the points that are in that cluster. So it's around something like n h by n, where n h is the number of points that I assigned to cluster h during this process. So now you can see that k-means is same as this, or at least very similar to the EM algorithm. When I don't estimate my covariance, and I fix it to be sigma I for every single cluster, and where sigma tends to zero. Okay. So k-means is essentially EM algorithm when I assume that my underlying clusters in Gaussian, in this mixture of Gaussians, are spherical and their covariance, or their variance, sorry, goes to zero. Okay. So that is sort of the punchline. Okay. So, I mean, so again, the same discriminative versus generative thing, that is, if you have small number of data points, then naturally, like if you want to estimate your covariance, you'll need many more data points. So you don't want to do that. You don't want to confuse your estimator. So if you don't have too many points and your dimensionality is too high, then use this discriminative type of method, just k-means type of methods, because they are fixing the covariance and they are just computing means. But if you have many more points than the dimensionality, then you should be able to estimate your covariances also very well. And in that case, the performance will be much better because I can estimate, my algorithm can adjust to the underlying covariances, right? So in practice, what can happen is that my clusters need not be spherical, right? They can be something like this. Whereas k-means, what it will try to do is it will try to approximate these clusters by spheres, right? And can incur some error. But if I estimate my covariances, then I'll be able to fit data exactly. Assuming that my EM is able to give me the true optima, it will be able to fit perfectly to this data set. Okay. But naturally, there are two disadvantages. One is that the number of data points that is needed for estimation will be larger. And the another disadvantage is that the procedure will be slower because I'm estimating this D by D matrices at each step, the covariance matrix. And on top of that, my indicator variables are also dense, as in for all, like these quantities will be non-zero for every single data point. So I have n by k quantities which are non-zero, whereas in k-means, only n quantities are non-zero. There is a factor of k loss there. So overall, the procedure will be slower. So this is clear when you should use k-means and when you should use EM, and what are the benefits of each of them. Okay, so now let's look at this general framework through which EM algorithms arrive. And it's actually a very interesting framework. And typically, like these are called variational inference methods in Bayesian models. Okay. So let's. It's written here. So suppose I want to do my maximum likelihood estimate. That is, I want to maximize my L of x comma theta, which is given by log p x given theta. Right? I just want to maximize this quantity. And sometimes it might be very hard to maximize it directly. For example, in the mixture of Gaussian case that we just saw, it is hard to maximize it directly. But the problem can become easier if I introduce some latent variables. Some variables which sort of gives rise to my data points, right? So for example, my latent variables in mixture of Gaussians was the cluster identity or cluster indicator. That is given that this point belongs to this particular cluster, then the estimation is easier, right? Then the probability distribution is simpler to handle. Then it's just a Gaussian, so estimation becomes easier. So that's why we want to introduce these latent variables z, so that we have x comma z given theta. Okay. And actually, this quantity can be written as some of these two very interesting quantities. I'll just define them in a minute. So let me actually call this as q of z comma theta plus kl of q of z to p of z, and I'll define these quantities. Okay. So here q is some other distribution. Okay. And so let me define these quantities. So r theta is equal to this is sum over all z. Qz log p of x comma z theta by qz
Just check. Ouch.
Yeah. And the other guys. And then KL divergence between this Q to P is given by summation over all Z. QZ log Z P of Z given X comma theta divided by QZ. So let's look till here, right? So I just want to maximize this quantity, right? And it might be very hard to do it in general. For example, in mixtures of Gaussians, there was no apparent way to do it, no easy way to do it. And there were, in fact, some singularities which were very problematic, right? So we said that, okay, let's introduce some extra variables that might make our problem easier, okay? So for example, in mixtures of Gaussians, we said that let's introduce this indicator variables. That is, point xi belongs to this particular cluster h. And as soon as we do that process, then our generation or then our probability distributions become very easier, right? Because then given that I have generated from this particular cluster, my cluster is now just a Gaussian. My distribution is just a Gaussian. So it becomes easier to handle, right? But it is not clear, or at least not a priori clear, that if you introduce these latent variables, and maybe some of the procedures, like let's say, you know, maximum likelihood estimate, given these latent variables, it's easier to optimize. How do you optimize this entire likelihood? That is, by introducing these latent variables, how you can say that you'll be able to optimize this? So we'll study that. So the goal of introducing these latent variables is that some of our maximum likelihood estimate problems will become easier. And we'll see how which problems or how they will come about. Okay. In mixture of Gaussian, the problems was that given this cluster center or given this cluster indicator, computation of my means and variances, that is my parameters, was very easy. So in that sense, the latent variables were very nice. That particular maximum likelihood estimate became very easy. No, even without fixing the variance. Like if I know my all the points in my cluster, I can compute mean and variance directly, right? It's just average of all the points and then average of sample covariance. Okay. So here we just want to see why that type of procedure that we studied, that alternative procedure, that is first assign clusters probabilities, that probability of this point belonging to that cluster, and then reweighing them or like computing means according to that weight was good. That was not clear, right? And it should become clear from this analysis. Okay, so let me just introduce one more variable or one more probability distribution, Q. Okay, and Q can be any probability distribution. Okay. And the claim is that my likelihood, that is L of x comma theta, can be decomposed into these two parts. That is likelihood with respect to this Q probability distribution plus the KL divergence between Q and P. So do you guys remember the KL divergence between, so KL divergence between, sorry, they should be minus, between two distributions, Q and P, is just given by this thing. So this is expected value of this log of P by Q, where expectation is taken with respect to Q, right? And it has some very nice property. For example, KL divergence of Q to P. So this can be thought of as a distance function for probability distributions. Whenever you want to, like suppose you have two probability distributions and you want to, you know, have a distance measure between them, you should consider KL divergence. It's a very natural distance function between two probability distributions. And it has nice properties. For example, very similar properties to distances. So distance between Q and P, that is KL divergence between Q and P, is always positive. And it is equal to zero if and only if Q is equal to P. that is the probability distributions match per, so this we can, let's just think about the discrete probability distributions, okay? That is, on every point in my support, my probability distributions should match. Then only the distance will be zero. Otherwise, it will be positive. Okay. So that is good part. Bad part about these things is that, number one, they are not symmetric. Is not equal to KL divergence between P and Q. Okay. And then they do not satisfy triangle inequality as well. That is KL of P to Q plus KL of Q to R need not be greater than equal to KL of P to R. They don't satisfy triangle inequality. Okay. So for this lecture, what you need to remember is this fact, that is, KL divergence is always positive or non-negative, and it is zero if and only if your two distributions match. Okay. So first, let's see why some of these two quantities will give me Lx theta, which is independent of Q altogether. Okay. So let's just, simplest thing is, let's just sum the two, right, and see what happens. So as soon as I sum these two quantities, you can see that the summation qz log 1 by qz, and then there is a minus summation qz 1 by qz. So that portion will cancel out, right? So only thing that will remain is, in this summation is, summation over all z, qz log of p x comma z given theta minus log of p x z given x by theta. So I'll just bring it down. So probability of z given x comma theta, right? And this by Bayes' rule is just p of x comma theta, right? Z given x comma theta is just z comma x by theta divided by probability of x by theta. Probability of x given theta. This is summation over z qz log of p x given theta. Okay? And this term is constant with respect to z or q. So you'll just have this. And now Q is a probability distribution. So this is 1. So we directly get that when direct theta is just log of Px theta. So we get this equality. Okay. Cool. So now once you buy this, and another thing is that my KL divergence is always positive. So L of x comma theta, that is my true likelihood, is always larger than likelihood with respect to this Q distribution, right? This is always true because this guy is positive. So L of Q comma theta is a lower bound on this guy. So now let's, from this intuition, let's try to derive the EM algorithm, okay? Or let's see what EM algorithm will do. So remember EM algorithm, what do? We, in the E step, we fix our theta to some theta old, okay? And then we try to maximize this conditional probability, or we try to estimate this posterior of latent variables. Remember, in the case of Gaussians, we try to estimate the probability that this particular point belongs to this particular cluster. That is, probability of zi is equal to h given my point xi and theta old. That's what I was trying to do, right, in case of Gaussians. So it is essentially just estimating this posterior over z, over my latent variables. Okay? That is estimate p of z given x comma theta. And so here, if you look at this quantity, it seems like these latent variables will depend on all the points, right? So how will you estimate them? But good thing is that since I know that each of my xi is independent, so I can write this as I is equal to 1 to n probability of z given, how should I write it? Given theta, sorry, times, I will be able to write this as in pi z. Summation over all z, comma theta, and that's why I will be able to compute these quantities separately. Okay. So, like, point is that independence of xi's will help us at computing z's independent of each other. So, latent variable for each of the point will be independent of the other guys. Okay, so that's a minor point. But let's look at, so what does this estimating p of z comma z given x comma theta means in light of this decomposition? Okay, so suppose I have fixed my theta old. So as soon as I fix my theta, what happens? And suppose I want to maximize this likelihood with respect to q, right? I want to maximize this quantity, with respect to q, I have fixed theta to be old, theta old. Then we know that since this quantity is not at all dependent on q, so if I make this large, this has to go down, right? If I maximize this, this has to be minimized because their sum is a constant. Is that clear? Their sum does not depend on q at all. So if I maximize with respect to q while fixing theta, then this quantity has to go down. And how much it can go down? Well, zero. And when that happens? When q is equal to p, right? So what it will say? That my qz is equal to this pz probability distribution, which is this p of z given x comma theta, right? Is this stuff clear? That is, if I fix my theta old and if I try to maximize this quantity, this will have to go down and I'll have to set q is equal to p. So that would immediately give me that I should set my probability distribution q to this posterior, which is precisely what we do, right? And since I'm, so like suppose, you know, for theta old, I had some other q, and now as soon as I maximize, I will increase the lower bound, right? I will increase this guy. Okay. So let me. So MSTAB, what it is doing is like fix theta to be old, and then optimize or maximize LQ theta old with respect to Q. And what it will do in, let's look in picture terms. So let's say this is my likelihood of x and theta old. Then I know that this is some of these two positive quantities. So let's say this is my L, Q, let me call this as old, and then theta old, right? And this was my KL divergence. Q old to P old, where P is this, right? Some of these two quantities will give me my likelihood. Both the quantities are positive, so this picture makes sense. And now what we are doing is we are saying that we'll fix this Q old and we'll try to maximize for Q so that the KL divergence is minimized. That is, I will take this guy here, Right. So now my L Q comma theta old is here at this level of my Lx theta old. Okay. And now let's look at the M step. So in M step, what do? I fix my Q and I maximize for my theta. Right? Fix Q or posterior and maximize for my model parameters theta. Right? Maximize with respect to theta. And since, I'm trying to maximize this guy while fixing Q. So as soon as I maximize it, it should definitely increase a little bit, right? So what will happen in M step? So I will increase this quantity to some L Q theta nu, right? Okay. And I know that this quantity is a lower bound on Lx theta nu. So my Lx theta nu will lie somewhere here, where this distance is KL divergence between, again, my Q nu and P nu. Right? My posterior will also change according to the thetas. So is it clear what is going on? So essentially what KL is trying to do is, it is trying to increase this lower bound on my likelihood. Okay, that is all it is trying to do. And the way it is doing is, it says that, okay, let's fix Q old and maximize for Q. And the way you will maximize for Q is that by setting this KL divergence to be zero, that is, I'll set my Q to be P. That is, I'll set my Q to be my posterior. QZ will be set to be this posterior of Z. Right? And once I do that, then I will fix my Q and I'll maximize for my theta. And since it's maximum likelihood estimate, I'm maximizing this quantity will increase. As soon as this quantity increases, my likelihood will also increase, overall likelihood increase. And that's how it will go on. That is, now once I have reached this level, I will again fix my theta. I'll increase this boundary to here. And that will, and then again maximize with respect to theta and so on. I'll just keep on increasing my likelihood function. Okay. And it will converge when the new Q that I find is exactly equal to the old P. That is old Q. There is no increment there. And that can happen. As in, even if I am far away from the optima, still that can happen. So EM, there is no global optimality proof for EM, or not in general cases. You can get stuck in local minima. You can converge to something which is not optimal, that is where Q is not equal to your theta is not equal to theta star. You can converge to that sort of thing. Okay. So we haven't properly talked about, so I just loosely said that, okay, we'll do this. Let's just look at this step and what this will sort of give us an idea how to design these latent variables. What sort of latent variables should we compute? So one thing that you learn about latent variables is that this posterior should be easy to estimate. And that was the case in the Gaussian case. Because all I had to do was this step is reasonably easy as long as you can factorize your probability distribution in terms of your latent variable, which was happening in mixture of Gaussian. As soon as I fix my cluster indicator, I have just a Gaussian distribution. So the factorization in terms of the latent variables are very easy, right? So that should be number one criteria, that your latent variables should be such that you can easily factorize, right? Then another thing that we need to do is this M step, which is maximization of L Q theta with respect to theta, right? This maximization is with respect to theta. Okay. And let's just write this quantity. So this quantity is this, right? Summation Q Z log P x z given theta divided by q z. And we know that this qz log qz, this term is not dependent on theta. This is dependent on, it is definitely dependent on the theta, but on the older theta. The new theta that we are optimizing is just this. So we can easily ignore this guy. This is just a constant, right? Okay. So this quantity is very interesting now. What is this? This is sort of, and we know that qz from this step is pz given, p of z given x comma theta. This posterior over z, right? So this quantity is expected value according to this latent variable z of my log likelihood. Log of p x comma z. Okay. So remember I was saying that like in EM what the issue was that just write it down again. That our, if you recall for our Gaussian case, our log likelihood, our likelihood of x comma theta was log of summation pi k and then n xi given theta, right? Or pi h goes from 1 to k, right? And this summation was inside log, and we were not able to do much. But now using this type of decomposition, what we are able to do is, we are able to bring this summation out, and here we are just left with our latent variables. Okay. So what you should be able to do is, you should be able to optimize for this step as well. So your latent variables should be such that you can optimize for this step. Is that clear? Oh, by the way, this is theta old. This is fixed. So with respect to a fixed probability distribution, you want to maximize or expected value of your this type of likelihood function, this joint likelihood function, with respect to a fixed probability distribution on posterior. Okay. Okay. So. So basically you can, and in some cases what can happen is that you might not be able to maximize it. Your probability distribution might not be that simple. So in case of mixtures of Gaussians, things factor out very well, you can do it. But in some cases you might not be able to. So what you'll try to do is, you'll try to just increase it a little bit by, let's say, doing some sort of gradient descent method or something like that. Using some method, you'll just increase this guy and then proceed. So even EM will work in that case as well, right? Because as soon as I, so all I need to do is I need to increase this boundary. I want to find theta nu so that this likelihood is increased. And as soon as I do that, my this boundary will shift. Sure, I might not be able to increase as much as I would have liked, but even if I increase it a little bit, there is a hope that EM will get to a better solution. Okay. So this is called generalized EM, that is where you are not able to solve the M estimate exactly, M step exactly, but you are able to solve it approximately. And even that is good enough for EM to at least give you a slightly better solution. Okay. So is this clear? So what are the sort of, oh, 10 minutes fast. So again, very high level, what did we study? We saw that, okay, EM algorithm, what it does is, in the case of mixtures of Gaussian, it is just estimating the probability of one point belonging to each of your clusters. And then once you are given that, you'll compute your means and covariances according to, like, by just averaging over all your points weighted by those probabilities, right? And then we saw that actually, if you take the case of special case of spherical Gaussian, where you have fixed your covariance, or sorry, your variance to be just a diagonal matrix, in fact, just one single number in all the directions, and you take it to zero, then it actually gives you back the k-means algorithm. So k-means algorithm can be thought of as a hard version of EM, where your probability densities of being, you know, one point being in a particular cluster is one or zero. rather than it being a soft number like between 0 to 1. Okay, so it's a hard assignment. Okay, and then we saw that, okay, why should such methods work? Why should they increase my likelihood? So we saw that, okay, what essentially happens is that you can decompose your likelihood in terms of these two factors, where you have a likelihood with respect to some other distribution Q, and then you have KL divergence of Q to this posterior P. And then we said that, okay, EM algorithm all it does is fix theta nu and optimize for Q, which will require me to set Q to be the posterior of latent variables. And then in the next step, I will fix my Q, that is, I'll fix my posterior, and I'll maximize with respect to my theta and just iterate. And that will definitely increase my likelihood at each step. It is essentially increasing the lower bounds on likelihood, and that's why overall it will increase the likelihood. Okay. Any questions? Any doubts? So this EM algorithms are like, you know, they are very powerful, and you can use it for other graphical models other than, you know, mixtures of Gaussian. So I think next class we'll see how they can be used for these latent Dirichlet allocation methods, which are used for topic modeling. They're very popular for topic modeling, and there are certain reasons for it. So next class, which is next to next week. Next week we won't have any class. Okay. And Yun had an announcement. So homework number two. Yes. Homework number two is, and what is the deadline? 20th. Okay, so the deadline is 20th. Homework is on website.